DOS games defined a generation, but are surprisingly difficult to play nowadays. While many games are fine, others suffer from anything from input lag to sound issues, so in this video, I'm going to show you how to have your retro PC dualboot DOS and Windows 98. Windows 95 and 98 come with their own versions of DOS, but for compatibility, something older is sometimes better. Hardware is a major issue to bear in mind, so for this demonstration, I'm using a 500MHz CPU with 32MB of RAM. If you can get a hold of a Pentium 2 PC, that's even better than what I'm using. The hardware you use should have drivers for Windows 98 and DOS. The components most likely to give you trouble are the sound card and GPU. DOS somewhat predates PCI, and most enthusiasts suggest using an ISA sound card if you can get one. However, if you're lucky, your motherboard may have an ES1373 or similar chip on it, which will give Sound Blaster emulation. This is also available on certain audio PCI branded sound cards. For GPUs, anything with 64MB or less will have at least some compatibility, with a slight preference towards AGP cards. If you can find an old S3 GPU, that's a solid bet, otherwise Nvidia TNT is preferred alongside early ATI Rage. If you're certain your hardware will work, we can move on to the actual installation. We'll start by inserting the Windows floppy. We want to use the fdisk command to start the partition editor. Depending on the drive you're using and whether you're using a compact flash to IDE adapter, you might get a warning about your drive size. If you do, go ahead and enable large disk support. On the next screen, we first want to check whether we have any partitions using option 4. We can see here that I do have some, so I need to delete that first using option 3 on the previous screen. After confirming the deletion, the drive is wiped and ready for formatting. Back on the fdisk screen, we now need to create a partition with option 1. We need a primary partition, so we choose that and choose the maximum. This will be about 2GB, leaving 2GB free on the particular drive I'm using. It now wants to reboot, so power off, then on again, switching to the MS-DOS install disk as we do. The installer will boot from any of the disks, but the first disk is what will actually start the process. So if you're using disks you made using an image, you might need to fiddle around a little if you didn't label them. Once the right disk is finally in, we'll get a welcome screen. Hit enter to continue, then choose format drive. This stage takes a while since it's running a good old-fashioned check disk as it goes, so feel free to get a coffee. IDE drives are not famed for being fast, and mine took just under 5 minutes to format the 2GB partition we made. Once it's done, you'll have the option to set the keyboard and language. If you're not in the US, follow the instructions and set the time while you're at it. If the time is way off base, make a note to check the BIOS later, and if it's wrong in there too, buy some CR2032 batteries as your CMOS battery may have died. Once you've done that, tell it the settings are right and on the next screen, skip through. C/DOS is the correct install path, and now we just need to wait for the install to finish, swapping disks as needed. This stage of the install took me about 6 minutes, so feel free to get another coffee or make some toast or something. When done, remove the floppy, and you'll now boot into MS-DOS. You'll notice that the screen doesn't clear the BIOS post output, and simply drops you into a shell. This is intended behaviour, so don't worry. If you want to clear the screen, use the command CLS. I do this a few times in the video to pretend I remembered everything correctly. To install the CD driver, we use the command copy /oakcdrom.sys /c:\dos. This is a generic driver that'll work with most IDE CD drives for reading disks. If it says a file copied successfully, we can continue to the next step, telling DOS to load the driver. To do this, we want to use the command edit config.sys, and under the line about HiMem, add /device:\dos/emm386.exe /noems. This tells DOS to explicitly use a different memory allocation scheme. EMS is an older standard for when we only had a few megabytes to work with, but that's for another video to discuss. Under that, we need another line, device:\c:\oakcdrom.sys/d:\cdrom. No backslash before CD-ROM. Hit Alt to bring up the menu, choose Save, then Alt again and exit. We need to edit one more file, so use the command editautoexec.bat and under the echo line type /c:\dos\msc-dex\d:cd-rom, then save as last time. Now we can go ahead and reboot, just power off then on again. You'll notice the output on boot has changed a little this time. Now DOS is mentioning the Oak driver and giving some basic output about the CD drive. This is good and means we can put the Windows CD in. You could copy the installer to the hard drive to make it faster, but we'll run it directly. Type D:\ to switch to the drive, CD Win98 to switch to the installer folder, then set up to actually run it. It'll run a couple of checks first, so hit enter to give it permission. My capture card got a little screwy at this point because the installer and DOS are in slightly different resolutions, giving my upscaler some trouble. The important parts are visible though, and the installer is relatively simple to run through, but it does take about half an hour in total, so we'll cut some parts of the video. The directory we'll want is C/Windows, so leave that as is and hit next. Choose a custom install, just so we can validate settings as we go. If you want any extra components, now's the time to select them. Next, name your computer whatever you want and double check the keyboard settings and location. Hit next on the startup disk option and put a blank floppy in if you want to make one, otherwise hit cancel in the dialog that comes up. Now it'll start actually installing and this will take a while. Eventually you'll be asked to reboot. Some of the boards won't get the signal to auto boot from the hard drive, so if it ends up booting back into the first part of the installer, take the CD out until you pass the BIOS. You'll need to wait a few minutes while some config files are updated, then it'll start booting. Enter your username and agree to the license and give it your product key. It'll start setting up hardware now. Click through any driver install windows that come up. It'll try to get the driver from the CD, but if it can't, don't worry. You can install anything that's not included from USB or floppy afterwards. At some point, you'll be asked to choose your time zone, so do that when asked. Again, the process takes a while and there may be a couple reboots in the process. The main thing is to just let it run until you get to a desktop. In total, the Windows installer took my computer about 40 minutes. Now that Windows is installed, you'll notice that it'll only boot to Windows by default rather than giving you an option. To fix this, open My Computer and head to the C drive. Go to View, Folder Options, the View tab in the window that comes up, and choose to show all files and not hide the extensions for known types. We also need to allow all uppercase names and display the full path in the title bar. Hit Apply, then at the top of the window, apply this to all folders on the drive with a Light Current Folder option. Now, find the msdos.sys file, right-click it, hit Properties, and uncheck Read Only. Apply it, right-click again, choose Open With, and open it in Notepad. In the Options section under Boot GUI, add the setting Boot Menu equals 1. Save the file, then make it read-only again. Now we can reboot, and as you'll see, we now have a boot menu. Normal boot is the default, which will take you into Windows after 30 seconds or when you hit Enter. But if you go down to Option 7, you'll be able to boot into MS-DOS 6.22 instead.